How do you write the perfect Bond theme song? Of the 25 Bond films that have been made, 24 of them begin with an iconic song that accompanies an equally iconic title sequence. And although the film that began it all uses an instrumental theme instead of a song, the story of any good Bond theme has to begin with this music, written by Monty Norman and John Barry. The James Bond theme acted as the blueprint for everything that would follow, containing the musical DNA that could turn a normal song into a theme tune worthy of Bond. The first key component is the orchestration. John Barry's big band, jazzy arrangement brings you instantly into Bond's world. The use of swing drums and Vic Flick's guitar riff combined with the bluesy brass gives the music a confident and hard-edged nature. And though this arrangement doesn't include any strings or piano, these instruments would, over the years, become fundamental parts of the sound world. The next thing to think about is the harmony. Like the original theme, the best Bond songs are in minor keys with added blues notes. Although there are some chords that are unquestionably associated with Bond films, like a minor chord with an added ninth and sharp seventh, the signature Bond harmony comes from the opening to Norman's theme, a sequence of four simple chords. A minor triad, where the top note moves chromatically up and down, shifting between the fifth and sharpened sixth degree of the scale. This is found in almost every Bond theme, either in the form we've just heard, or where the chord moves alongside the chromatic line, giving us the minor tonic chord, then the sixth chord, followed by the major four chord. This is the harmony that makes up the chorus for Casino Royale's theme tune. It's used as the basis for Adele's Skyfall. And is also the harmony that's found throughout Radiohead's Spectre. Sam Smith's Writings on the Wall is the official theme song for Spectre, but it was Radiohead that were initially approached to provide a song for the 24th installment in the franchise. They first submitted their 1995 song, Man of War, which was recorded as part of their sessions for The Bends. Man of War was, in Tom York's words, written as a melodramatic homage to the sound of Bond themes, but it was, understandably, rejected for Spectre, as it wasn't written specifically for the film. But Radiohead asked for a second chance. They halted work on their upcoming album and focused their attention on writing a new song for Spectre. And what they came up with is, in my opinion, one of the greatest Bond themes ever written. Spectre begins with a quiet, inward-looking voice. We hear this repeating sequence of chords in strings and piano, G major 7 followed by E sus2, which turns into E minor. This is Bond, but it's also unmistakably Radiohead. Their love of rhythmical ambiguity is present straight away. If you listen without the score, it feels like the piano chords are on stressed beats, and the idea in the final bar in the sequence is working against the pulse. But it's actually the other way around. The piano is playing triplet figures against the pulse in 3-4, and the last bar is lined up with the pulse. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. Radiohead's trademark harmonic ambiguity is also present here. As we move into the first verse, the song shifts into D major, going against the implied B minor tonality of the opening. the piano part, a descending line slowly moves downwards, leading us into the true tonic, B minor. As the strings then re-enter, the drum part accents the triplet figures in the piano. It's introspective but insistent, reserved but deliberate. The strings are starting to develop now. They play repeated chords that mimic the piano rhythm. And as we move back into D major, they take on the descending piano line in octaves, forming weightless clusters of notes above York's floating melody. The beauty and simplicity of the music contrasts painfully with the words, "Anger is a poison," these rumors and suspicions. It captures perfectly that dichotomy in contemporary Bond, a man struggling to reconcile love and duty. The truth that York speaks of here is found in these fleeting moments of expressivity and fragility in the strings. But the music and story are about to change. As we move to the end of the second verse, we get a sudden introduction of an E major tonality, the classic Bond harmony, the major four chord in B minor. And then a crystallization, a transposition into B major. Brass play these punchy, accented chords whose rhythm matches the triplet piano figure, and strings in octaves sing out this sliding, aggressive melody. The D naturals in the strings clash violently with the chords underneath, recalling the similarly aggressive clashes found in Bond songs of the past. It's jazzy but discordant. It's a modern reimagining of John Barry's big band orchestrations. But as we move back into the verse, Radiohead's characteristic orchestration reemerges. An ethereal wave of D major, replete with gossamer string lines and electronics, a sudden cleansing beauty. Then a pairing back. This repeating triplet idea that has persisted throughout the song now seems to be urging the music onwards. Each new four-bar phrase adds more parts in strings. Notes are added to the repeating chords, and we get sustained parts at the top of the texture in octaves. The strings are about to bring the music back to life. Violins take us from the darkness of the B minor tonality back into bright B major. Now, finally, we hear a complete rendition of the signature Bond harmony. B major, followed by G major, and then E major. The chromatic line around the fifth and sixth degree of the scale pushes the harmony forward as the strings play these fragmented, sensuous melodies that continue to writhe against the rhythm and harmony in the parts underneath, creating a complex web of melody and rhythm. What's astonishing about all of this is that this song was rejected. For me, it's the perfect combination of Radiohead and Bond. It's full of the classic harmony and orchestration that makes a great Bond theme, that ties it to Norman and Barry's music from the first feature film, but it's also by itself an instantly compelling and dark musical world. It just goes to show that even if something comes second, it doesn't necessarily mean it's second best. Sometimes the truth can only be seen by looking in the shadows. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed the video. And if you did, then take a look at my other essays analysing Radiohead songs, linked in the description. And if you'd like to purchase a PDF of the score for my transcription of Spectre, then take a look at my new music notes page, also linked below. Over the next few months, I'm going to be adding lots more items to the page, including transcriptions and arrangements of scores I've used in my past videos. See you next time.